that Putin actually invaded this time?
Yeah, I think most people were surprised. Maybe even Putin was surprised.
Yeah, and your perspective is that even before he actually sent troops in, that he was heading for disaster. As soon as he sent troops in, that he was destroying his own ability to govern Russia. Is that fair?
I wrote an article called "Putin Has Lost," and the basic idea in the article was that Putin's been a double act, and he on the one hand, everybody knows he's this badass, ruthless killer, and on the other hand, he's this almost normal, pseudo democratic politician who can kiss babies and do deals with foreign leaders. And now he's kind of transformed himself into kind of more like a Kim Jong-un character. And that's something that won't play so well with the Russian people, and will also make it very, very hard for him to do deals with foreign countries, especially in Europe. Although it might make it easier to do deals with people like Xi Jinping.
Right. And how do you account for the love of Putin on many parts of the dissident right?
Well, the dissident right is essentially the sub-media. And the sub-media always have to automatically take the opposite line to the mainstream media, even when the mainstream media is occasionally right about something.
Yeah. So I think it's also that Putin seems masculine and does not seem to be particularly concerned about human rights or liberal notions, and that he seems
wait a minute, he's about 170 centimeters at the most, and that's probably an exaggerated figure. How can he possibly be masculine?
I mean, he's out there like he's wrestling, right? He's out there like wrestling and doing judo and things like that. I mean,
yeah, he's shown us his moobs. He's got really bad man boobs.
Well, anyway, I always thought of Putin as a pretty savvy leader until now. How about you?
Yeah, this is the thing. People thought that, okay, he's a bit of a cunt, but at least he's a kind of calculating, crafty cunt. So he's somebody who's rational, who probably will stick to a deal because it's in his best interests and so on. And now he's coming across as a little bit more unhinged. And that's not really, the image that people had of him. So he's kind of undercut his own image with his recent actions. He's unleashed a lot of dark energy, let's say.
Surprised at the universal disgust aimed at Putin and how all the European nations seem to be singing from the same hymn book, even though they've got a vital need for Russian energy?
Not really, because, I think we've seen our broader society move in a much more kind of hysterical direction. And, we've had this phenomenon where people get very, very emotional about things through social media. And so we're seeing something similar here. This is like a successor to things like Black Lives Matter, I guess, and other, online kind of hive mind hysterias. And so there is something in that. And I think to a certain extent, it's how things are weaponized now. It's instead of realpolitik, we have kind of emopolitik. So you kind of whip up a kind of storm of emotion about things, and this is what's happened in this case. And, you know, I think Putin's probably been surprised by that, because my guess is that Putin thought he was being the nice guy. He was going in with kid gloves. He was trying to avoid casualties, civilian casualties. And he thought he was, you know, making a play, but he was doing it quite, you know, carefully. He wasn't trying to wreck things too much. And he thought that probably that would be enough to diffuse some of the reaction. Obviously, he expected some sort of reaction from the West, but he thought it would be very disjointed, very disunited. There would be lots of squabbling and quibbling. They wouldn't be able to make their minds up. And by the time they did make their minds up, it would be all over. That was probably his calculation. And instead of that, they are leaping straight to, you know, Hitler, you know, Putin is Hitler. Putin is, you know, the second Holocaust. You know, they've made that emotional leap in a very, very short distance of time. And probably, you know, Putin might be surprised by that, or even devastated by that to some extent. I'd say Putin is not like Hitler. I'd say that, you know, both Hitler and Putin were dealing with quite serious geopolitical conundrums. Hitler was more driven by a kind of weird, irrational hatred of a certain group of people. Putin, as far as I can tell, he doesn't have a particular group of people that he irrationally, obsessively hates. So, but I mean, also in the case of Hitler, a lot of what Hitler did to that specific group of people was possibly also driven by events. And so if events pushed Putin down a particular dark, dangerous direction, he might end up doing something possibly as heinous and horrific as Hitler. Who knows?
Right. I mean, if we get into a nuclear war, it'd be worse than Hitler.
Yeah, that would be probably, in some ways, if it was a bad enough nuclear war, you could probably say that is maybe slightly worse than what Hitler did.
So when Putin put his nuclear forces on higher alert, do you think this was a serious escalation of the risk of nuclear war, or just a tactical move?
When I saw that, I thought he looked a little bit unhinged. He was kind of snarling and growling and trying to, like a little guy trying to look scary, I thought, you know. And also, you know, people talk about a midlife crisis, but, you know, I think there's such a thing as a late life crisis. And it's kind of dangerous having a lot of these very, very old people in charge of these very, very powerful nuclear arsenals. I mean, that's obviously the case with America. It was definitely the case with Donald Trump to some extent. And, you know, Putin is, I think he's going to be 70 quite soon. So, you know, these are all people who are quite advanced in age. And, you know, they've obviously, they've lived their lives. They're near in the end. They don't really have that much to lose. So we need to have much younger leaders. We need to have leaders who have families and children, and, you know, people who have a vested interest in a sane and rational future.
So this crisis has given a new importance and a new raison d'etre to NATO, which seemed like an institution that was dying on the vine. Do you have any thoughts on this?
I think when the Cold War ended, there was a an opportunity to restructure things and maybe to get rid of NATO and to replace it with some sort of European defense organization. And if they had done that, if they had created a European defense organization, then that might have been able to expand its membership up to the borders of Russia without appearing so threatening. But I think that's I don't really buy it that Putin feels militarily threatened by NATO. I don't think NATO is a kind of alliance that can go into countries and invade them, especially countries like Russia.
So what do you think Putin was trying to achieve?
I think Putin's he's much more focused on his domestic political concerns. I think he's much more worried about Western liberalism and democracy spreading through places like Belarus and the Ukraine and then lapping on the shores of Russia. That's probably the most scary thing for Putin, you know, because Putin is not a democratic leader by any stretch of the imagination. He's had to pretend to be a kind of pseudo-democratic leader. He's had to kind of hold elections. He's had to have different parties in the electoral cycle. But it's very, very controlled. You know, there's no real opposition. There's a kind of clown opposition of Zhirinovsky and the Communist Party. He controls the media. There's no real alternative. He can present himself as the kind of the sane, moderate candidate to most people. And, you know, who else are you going to vote for? So you end up voting for Putin if you're a Russian voter. You know, so there's no real choice. And if there is a real choice, if somebody rises up like a kind of a politician who seems to be resonating with the Russian voter, somebody like Navalny or is it Nemtsov, he then has them bumped off or, you know, imprisoned or whatever. You know, so Putin has been playing this part of a pseudo-democratic politician, but I'm pretty sure most Russian people, to some degree, know that he's not a democratic politician. And okay, you know, you can criticize Ukraine all you like, and you know that's all the distant right does these days is criticize the Ukraine and going about how it's a kind of puppet state of Joe Biden and it's totally corrupt. And you know, to a certain extent, there's you know, there's no smoke without fire there. But I think the Ukraine has has moved towards becoming a more typical sort of European style democracy with various parties competing for power and votes and so on, and a relative degree of free speech and so on. So it's sort of moving in. I mean, the Ukraine wants to be accepted by Europe. They're desperate to be accepted by Europe, and they're quite happy to, you know, do the sort of things that European states do, which is have elections, have individual rights, have, you know, gay rights or whatever it takes. And so they've been moving in that direction. And if they do that relatively successfully, you know, this is a large Russian-speaking country. It has a lot of connections with Russia still. That's going to be a conduit of Western liberal ideas and aspirations into Russia, and that's going to cause a upsurge of opposition to Putin. And of course, in the past, he's faced you know, challenges to his power. I think there were a lot of demonstrations against him about 10 years ago. And, you know, I think there's a very, very, not just a broad dissatisfaction with Putin, but there's also in some places a very, very deep dissatisfaction with Putin. And this is because he's basically been there so long. He's been there too long, and all the things that go wrong are blamed on him. And people do want to have a choice. And definitely he represents a lack of a choice. He represents a lack of freedom. People don't really feel they can be themselves. There is a suspicion that if they step out of line, things could go very, very badly for them.
So this will surely be the end of Putin. I mean, we wouldn't be surprised if he's overthrown or assassinated, right? Because surely there are a lot of powerful people in Russia who are not happy with the direction the country has taken with this invasion.
Yeah, you'd like to maybe think so, but it's very hard to predict something like that. It's, I mean, most of the oligarchs, they owe their fortune to Putin. You know, I mean, basically he appointed most of these people to these positions that made them extremely rich. And of course, that doesn't mean that they're going to be, you know, endlessly loyal to him. They're, you know, they're probably quite cunning, sneaky people who are interested in looking out for number one. But there's a sense that probably nobody wants to be the first one to move. You know, it's the first one to make the move is going to be the one that carries all the risk. And so it's like, I'll just, you know, stay in the background until somebody else does it. And then if that seems to be going well, I'll back them up. I think they're probably all playing the same plan there. And that, if everybody's thinking like that, if everybody's waiting for somebody else to stick the knife in, then you end up with a situation where nobody sticks the knife in.
Is there anything that's surprising you as you're watching this invasion unfold?
Yeah, well, let's see. It's just like, again, it's just like you can't take everything at face value, first of all. A lot of the things you see could be misrepresented. It could be bits of film from 2014. Who knows, there might be even, you know, various deep fakes going on. So you've got to take everything with a pinch of salt. The Russian army being a bit crap doesn't surprise me. I think the Russian army is, I mean, obviously it's got some sort of reputation, but there's no reason to think it's very, very well organized or very, very well run. I don't think the Russian army has ever been very, very efficient or very, very well run. It's very much a kind of blunt-edged tool. It can do well in certain situations. In other situations, it's not so well. And so the fact that we see these Russian convoys getting torched and blown up and attacked isn't too surprising. The great strength of the Russian army is, of course, that they can take losses, which, you know, most Western armies simply would, you know, freak out at.
Now, it definitely seems like this war is not popular in Russia. Is that fair?
How would we know? Because, first of all, apparently, the Russian media haven't even really told people the full truth. I mean, as far as they know, the Russian army is sort of hunkered down in Donetsk and Lugansk, preventing Nazis from genociding these poor Russians. And they haven't really told them about the full scope of the invasion, from what I can tell about the Russian media. Of course, it's filtered through to you know, various educated minorities who have good access to the internet. So it's very hard to tell the exact number of people who know about the war, and secondly, who oppose it. But we are seeing signs that it's unpopular. There are people coming out against it. And you know, this is the big thing: what's going to happen in Russia, as much as what's going to happen in the Ukraine. Is there going to be a mass movement against the war? Are people going to react to the economic sanctions and the effects of the economic sanctions? Is that going to spur some sort of opposition to Putin's government? Is that going to create enough instability that there's an opening for somebody to come in and become a focus for opposition. You know, all these questions will probably be answered in the next few days or the next couple of weeks. So it should be kind of very, very interesting to see what happens, because I mean, the sanctions have been, you know, quite heavy, quite united for the most part. And they seem to be quite serious about, waging economic war.
Now, is Putin's invasion of Ukraine the West's fault because the West kept expanding NATO and did not rule out bringing Ukraine into NATO? You still there, Colin?
Yeah, I heard your question. No, I don't think NATO or the West is to blame. And the reason for that is because NATO is not a threat to Russia, and Putin is probably sure of that himself. I don't think he actually literally thinks NATO is a threat. He doesn't literally think that the West is going to invade Russia. So that's simply not going to happen. So for Putin to pretend that NATO is a threat to him is disingenuous. What he's really afraid of, as I said earlier, is the idea that countries like Ukraine and Belarus might become beacons of democracy.
So one thing that might come out of this crisis is we'll get an idea of how serious governments are in Europe about meeting their energy needs. So throughout the Western world, there's been all these moves towards renewable energy sources that just are not getting the job done. So do you think that Germany, for example, might restart its nuclear program? Do you think that Europe might get more serious about its need for energy instead of living in a fantasy world where renewables are going to meet a need where they're simply not able to meet that need yet? Any thoughts?
Yeah, I think, another thing also is that the Russians have actually been financing the green movement in parts of Europe. The Russians obviously wanted to promote German energy dependence on Russia, and they've actually, I think there, I saw at least one story that mentioned Russian funding for the environmentalists. So I think the kind of, you see, also the reason people were so interested in green energy is because, again, it's a kind of moral signaling. This is something that the Germans are very, very prone to, of course. You know, the Germans love to moral signal. I can't think why. It's not like they ever did anything, bad in the past that would, need to be atoned for, is it? But anyway, the Germans love to do this. They love to morally signal. And environmentalism is one of the best ways, to look like a good person. And now they have another way to look like a good person, which is to, be against this new giant North Korean state that has suddenly manifested itself on the Eurasian landmass. And so I think the moral needs of European people to signal will be met in different ways from now on. They'll be able to help out Ukrainian refugees. They'll be able to talk about how nasty and evil Vladimir Putin is. And the appeal of green politics will probably go down. Also because it's very, very inconvenient to rely upon, Russian gas. And so they'll get back into things like, coal-powered power stations, and nuclear power will obviously, get a boost from this. So I think, this should be a bit of a game changer.
And I noticed the news media is appalled that people feel more empathy for Ukrainians than they say do for Syrians or Iraqis, because people in the West feel more in common with Ukrainians, their fellow Christians and their fellow Europeans. Do you have any thoughts on what seems to me just an obvious fact of life, that we tend to have more empathy for people who are like us?
Well, I think that gives Putin a new causes belli, you know, because you know, he obviously has to invade the rest of Europe to denazify it. Right.
Yeah, what do you think about Putin making the argument that he invaded to denazify Ukraine?
Well, this just shows that you know, we live in an emo political age rather than a real political age, and you know, you've got to have your emotional, touchy-feely narrative if you're, you know, going to do things in the world. And Putin obviously thinks, I've got to have a good, strong narrative that's going to play well with these hysterical, over-emotional Westerners. And so, yeah, I'll go for this anti-genocide, denazification narrative, which... you know, the Russia Today people have been pushing so hard.
Richard Spencer had a good line on Twitter. He said that sovereign is he who gets the power to name who the Nazis are.
Yeah, well, he would say that, wouldn't he? But yeah, I mean, I think a Nazi, anybody can say who a Nazi is. A Nazi is somebody who believes that the Jews have an inordinate amount of power, which they invariably use in a... civilizational destroying manner.
Yeah, and you made a point that Europe will now have to get more serious about meeting its energy needs and can't live in the delusion of green this and green that. And,
yeah, just to stay with the previous point. I mean, that's a typical Richard Spencerism, isn't it? I mean, it sounds quite impressive when you hear it. But when you think about it, it's actually quite stupid, because there's Vladimir Putin trying to call the Ukraine Nazis, and who buys it? Nobody buys it. So he doesn't have the power to call to decide who the Nazis are. I mean, you know, this is the thing. It's clearly hasn't worked. Probably nobody in Russia thinks the Ukrainians are Nazis. If the Russian army thought that the Ukrainians were Nazis, they would literally be going around machine gunning people, and they're not doing that.
So you're making the point that the Europeans can't be obsessed with green energy now that they've got a very serious energy need. They're going to have to meet it any way they can. And I think that's true for a whole bunch of things, that all sorts of people who are into woke politics and woke rhetoric are going to drop it as soon as it becomes inconvenient, as soon as they have more serious concerns. And an analogy would be between World War One and World War Two, there was a growing pacifist movement among the English elite, such as those who went to Oxford and Cambridge, and they passed resolutions that they'd never die for their country. But when the bell sounded, they went to war in World War Two. And so I think much of the woke approach to life is an indulgence. And when reality hits, people will simply drop it and deal with reality. And so,
yeah, but
go ahead.
I think they also need to find another alternative wokeness when they do that. And like I said earlier, they'll find another way to morally signal, which is, for example, they'll be about opposing Putin, or they'll be about helping Ukrainian refugees, or they'll be about raising money for the brave resistance fighters of the Galician forests or whatever, you know. So they're still going to find a way to be irritatingly moralistic. It'll just be in a different form.
Well, I've just been reading a book on this very topic, which actually inspired me to do a stream. It's called The Last Utopia, Human Rights in History. So you and I are old enough to remember there was a time when human rights weren't talked about very much. And then suddenly there was an explosion of talk about human rights. In the 1970s, human rights outside and apart from and threatening the state. So it used to be that rights were considered something that is that are accorded to citizens of a state, and you didn't hear a lot of talk about rights outside of the rubric of the nation state. Then starting in the late 1970s, we get this explosion of talk about human rights that exist outside of the nation state. So that's going to be one new utopia. So this book is called The Last Utopia: Human Rights in History, and this guy's a leftist Jew at Yale, professor of law, and he makes the point that human rights were invented and developed as an obsession when all the other utopias failed, when Marxism failed, when other left-wing utopias failed, that left-wing intellectuals seized upon human rights. Any thought about the development of human rights as a preeminent issue, how it just suddenly exploded in the late 1970s?
I guess you could see it as an aspect of Western liberalism and Western individualism, and also a kind of attempt to create a kind of unipolar system. Because who decides on the human rights? The West decides what human rights are and who should have them. And it's also a corollary of individualism and the sacredness of the individual and the individual's freedom. So it all ties in with Western liberalism. The idea that socialism and especially communism were becoming sort of intellectually bankrupt at that point.
Yeah, and from a realistic perspective, it just doesn't make much sense to talk about human rights outside of the nation state, because there aren't any international institutions that have great power unless particular nation states want to align with them. So would you agree with me that the realistic way to understand human rights are that they are afforded by a particular people or a particular nation state at a particular point in time, and they don't really have much universal meaning?
Well, they have a kind of imperialistic utility. I mean, one of the things that you see, I mean, going back long before the 1970s and the 1960s, one of the things you see is the colonization of Africa. And this was driven by people like, David Livingstone and so on. And one of the ways that it was justified was because these poor benighted Africans were being exploited by these cruel Arab slave traders. And so, the extension of European power was often predicated on the idea that we're there to, bear the white man's burden. We're there to improve things for the natives. So it sort of fits into that pattern, I feel. And you can see the same thing in the 1970s. You have the Soviet Union is starting to kind of become a bit decrepit, and America has been militarily defeated in Vietnam, and so they are changing their tactics, so to speak, of how to fight the Soviet Union, and of course, adopting the cause of human rights is one way to undermine Soviet power, because this is a society that wasn't really that deferential to individual human rights.
So I remember about a year or two ago, there was an academic who was, I believe, praising your writing on Russia. Am I remembering that correctly?
Yeah. There was... this guy, I think his name is George Michael. Professor George Michael, not the one that hangs around men's public toilets in London parks, who's sadly passed away a few years ago.
So what do you remember? What was he praising you for? And how long have you had a keen interest in things Russian?
Well, who's saying I'm the best thinker about Russia and the dissident right? So, you know, which wouldn't be hard, to be honest. You know, but yeah, I've been interested in Russia for a while. You know, because well, you know, my uncle used to live there many, many years ago, and you know, just. You know, growing up in you know, in Britain, when I did, it was kind of hard to ignore Russia. You know, there was that was the height of the Cold War. There was the ever present threat of nuclear destruction. So it was very, very difficult to not be interested in Russia at all. You know, I mean, very, very big presence, let's say.
I'm thinking one of the developments out of this Ukraine invasion is that we'll have a stronger, more cohesive and united Europe. Do you see prospects for that?
Yes, but you know, Europe can, you know, I mean, one of the problems with Europe is you have all these. Sometimes it's like herding cats. Everybody's got their own agenda, and right now there seems to be a lot of unity, and you know, everybody seems to be pulling together, and it's kind of quite easy for them now to all be on the same page. But you know, the problem is Europe is inherently divided, and they tend to go in different directions. There's lots of little rivalries. They kind of niggle each other. Different groups, different countries, well, various countries dislike other countries, and they have you know, rivalries with, which go way back, and you know, all this kind of historical baggage gets in the way, and so it's not too difficult for a large united country like Russia, if it was well run, to play upon those divisions to its own advantage. And the Russians have been doing that quite successfully up until now. And of course, you know, there's this temporary effect that you get when something quite shocking like this happens, but after a while this will become normalized. There'll be a new status quo. We're not quite sure what will happen. Maybe Putin will get bumped off, maybe a new leader will come in, maybe Putin will manage to stabilize his position and reorganize the Ukraine in a way that suits himself. But whatever happens, there'll be a new steady state at some point, but there'll probably still be a large, powerful Russia, and there'll be a very inherently divided Europe that can be manipulated in various ways. So, at the moment, yes, to your question, but in the long run, it's not a reliable thing. I think Russia is a destabilizing influence in Europe, in the same way that Germany used to be. And that's the main problem of European geopolitics, is how to stop Russia playing this destabilizing role. So I think we basically need a kind of Morgenthau plan for Russia.
But I mean, isn't Russia just self-destructing with its abysmal demographics?
Not really, because they're going to replace the population with their orc army of Chechens and Central Asians, and you know, unite around the radical traditionalism of an invigorated Islam and Russian Orthodoxy.
And what's going on in Japan with regard to skyrocketing energy prices and complications from this Russian invasion of the Ukraine?
Yeah, a lot of moaning, but, you know, nothing else.
And you called it months ago. I listened to your short pod on why you did not expect Boris Johnson to resign. So one of the advantages of a crisis like this real news of Russia invading Ukraine is that the silliness, there's just not as much time for it. And so for months, we were hearing about how Boris Johnson was about to be toppled. And you don't hear that anymore. He seems much more secure in his role. And you called it out. You said that it's highly unlikely that he's going to go anytime soon. Any thoughts?
Yeah, in a way, there's a kind of, how can I say, a kind of parallel with Putin, because Putin sets up his own opposition. And so if you want to get rid of Putin, you have to have, okay, you've got to go and vote for the Communist Party or Vladimir Zhirinovsky, who's a complete, you know, nut job, or, you know, pretends to be. And so people just think, now I'll just stick with Putin again. You know, I don't like him, but, you know, he's better than those other two. And that's basically what, you know, Boris Johnson has done inside the Conservative Party. He's filled all the other prominent positions with Asian politicians. So if you bump off Boris, then you get Rishi Sunak, an Indian, running the country, or Priti Patel, a female Indian, running the country, or you get Savid Javid or somebody like that. And most people in the Conservative Party are not really there yet. I mean, they're pretty woke, but they're not that woke.
And what do you think about the direction of America First?
Yeah, I was saying earlier that, you know, old leaders are not a good thing, and we need more young leaders. And so, yeah, we need somebody in their 20s to kind of rise up and offer America the hope for the future, you know. So that's definitely what we need. Yeah, we need a young leader, like somebody like that, who has a very, very gifted communicator who can reach out to the masses. And you know, we've got to get away from these octogenarians and move to somebody like a Zoomer.
Now, you mentioned that Nick's latest speech was kind of boring. And you also make the point that he's an incredibly gifted communicator, but he's not a man of deep ideas. He has a more facile approach and incredibly good at communicating it, but there's not a lot of depth there. Is that a fair summary?
Yeah, I found it boring, yeah, because his speech was like content free. There was no content, there were no ideas, there were, you know, it was just all rhetoric. And, you know, I found that extremely boring, but maybe, you know, most people would find it quite a good speech. They'd find, they'd project all sorts of things into his empty words. So yeah, he's obviously a very skilled communicator. He's a very skilled politician, I would say, at some stage. You know, he might even do very, very well. Who knows? I mean, it's hard to predict these things, but I wouldn't be surprised if he turned out to be a very, very successful politician, because he's got all the worst characteristics that make politicians successful.
So Baked Alaska predicts he'll be president one day.
Yeah, who knows? That might be you know, very sound prediction. You know, America's I just think America's the kind of country that could actually, you know, put Nick Fuentes in the White House. It is that kind of country. You know, I mean, that's what I want to say about America. And yeah, there is something funny about America in that respect.
And is there anything about American politics that's caught your attention the past couple of months?
I'm trying to dredge it up if there is, but I do occasionally check in. You know, like Trump hasn't really resurfaced in a meaningful way. I think he was at CPAC, wasn't he? He made some speech. Mm-hmm. That didn't really cause us much of a stir, as far as I can tell. I think they're trying to kill his signal as much as possible. There's the of course there's the AFPAC thing, which had a very interesting and maybe eclectic cast there. A lot of people came. I think Jared Taylor and Peter Brimelow were there. So they kind of see Nick as the new Richard Spencer, you know. And what else is going on? It's hard to really put my finger on it, on anything that really stands out.
And what about in France? We've got the candidacy of Eric Zemmour. Do you think he's a serious possibility of a future French leader?
Well, I think he's, I think he's really controlling the election in a way. He's sort of pushing, as they say, pushing the Overton window, and he's made it. He's made a lot of room for some of these narratives and tropes that would normally be excluded from the political discourse, and that in a way might work in, you know, Marine Le Pen's favor, because, you know, I think Zemmour himself will be too he'll be seen as too radical or too extreme to be accepted as a winning candidate. And so somebody else might pick up that radical energy that he's unleashed. And I think that might benefit Marine Le Pen, or it might benefit the other French woman. I can't remember her name. Can you?
No, you mean Marine Le Pen's niece?
No. The kind of more center-right woman.
I don't remember.
What's her name? Anyway, she seems to be trying to pick up some of that energy as well. She said a few things which are probably a lot more right-wing than she would otherwise have said. So I think Zemmour is pushing the whole debate a little bit in the towards the right, and that's going to have some impact. The other problem, though, with the French election is that these populist right-wing candidates are going to suffer to some degree due to an association with Vladimir Putin.
Right.
Yeah, we've got to dig up this woman's name, because I think if you sort of put all the pieces together, she's got a very strong chance of unseating Richard Spencer's boyfriend.
Valérie Pécresse,
yeah, that sounds like her. Yeah, Valérie Pécresse. I think she has a, because I think Le Pen, she has been associated to some degree with Putin. Salvini in Italy, he used to be a big Putin fan, you know. So all these people, all these kind of populist right-wing politicians who are quite prominent in various European countries, they might get a little bit of a negative effect from what's going on in the Ukraine, and some more boring center-right candidates might pick up the energy there.
So I noticed a lot of commentary in the media about Putin fans, but almost all the Putin fans are people who simply respect Putin's as a savvy leader. They're not necessarily a fan. And so it seems that in the media it's been conjoined, that those who have recognized that Putin is doing a pretty good job in a difficult situation until the Ukraine invasion on behalf of his people, that doesn't mean that you don't also recognize that he's a gangster and that, you know, he kills people he doesn't like. But there seems to be a conflation of respecting Putin as a savvy leader and being a fan of Putin. Do you think there's a meaningful difference there? Because I do.
There is that. There's that sense that people respected him as a kind of crafty, cunning, clever, calculating politician. That doesn't necessarily mean that they like him or agree with his policies or what he believes in.
Right.
But that provides a basis for people to sort of sit down with him and do a deal and But there is that Yeah, but as I was saying earlier, I think he has kind of undermined that to a large extent. But of course, if he manages to come out of this, this present gamble on top, then of course that's going to reassert itself. They're going to say that, you know, Putin really is this 4D chess master and blah blah blah, this, that, and the other. You know, so it all depends on how this this thing in the Ukraine turns out. And I think it is quite an important, event, because if Putin is successful and he gets his way after doing what was the, after launching the biggest military campaign in Europe since 1945, that's going to make the Western alliance look a little bit weak. The West, in the aftermath of this, the West is going to look quite weak and impotent, and unwilling to kind of stand up and fight for territory. And the Chinese are going to get a signal from that, that the West, including America, is not prepared to stand up and fight. And this has always been the problem that the West has. The West is not able to take casualties in the various military campaigns that the West has been involved with. And this has always been a problem. I mean, in Vietnam, I think America was able to take about 50,000 dead, is that right?
Right.
Which was pretty impressive by today's standards. Of course, the Vietnamese were able to take about 2 or 3 million dead. And the Chinese in the Korean War were able to take a lot of casualties. And then later on, I remember in the 1980s, the U.S. Marines, who are supposed to be the real tough guys of the American Empire, they went into Beirut. Boom, car bomb, 200 dead Marines. The next day, the Americans are trying to pull out. And the same thing in Somalia with the Black Hawk Down, some Americans got killed there. And as soon as they could manage it, the American forces were pulled out. And so America keeps sending out this signal of weakness. And if Putin is able to rearrange the Ukraine to his liking after this full-scale invasion, the Chinese are going to rightfully conclude that Taiwan is theirs for the taking. The Americans are not going to step up and fight for it.
And what do you think Putin wants beyond the Ukraine? Let's say he crushes Ukraine, takes Ukraine. Will he be satisfied, or do you think he has further ambitions such as the Baltic states?
Yeah, I think he wants to. He does have specific demands, and he does. He wants NATO forces to stay behind the line that they held when the Soviet Union was all powerful. So, apparently, Putin's vision is that countries like Poland and Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia can stay in NATO, but no NATO forces from other NATO countries should be deployed in those countries. That's kind of what he's aiming at, I think. So all the Germans have to stay in Germany, all the British have to stay in Britain, and so on. And so right now there's British troops deployed in Estonia, which is, very, very close to St. Petersburg, Putin's hometown. And so he doesn't want to see any of that. And also, of course, he doesn't want countries like Finland and Sweden to join. And right now they're kind of seriously thinking about joining NATO after what happened to the Ukraine.
And have you been reading any good books lately?
Yeah, probably. Let me just have a look around. What have I been reading? I can't find it. Where is it? Oh, there it is. Yeah, okay. I was reading Gunter K. Koshkorek, Blood Red Snow.
And what's that about?
Well, this is actually quite appropriate to what's happening, because this is about this is the memoirs of a German soldier on the Eastern Front. And basically, this guy was fighting in the Ukraine. He was fighting against the Red Army, and it's the same terrain that is being fought over today. So, you know, I was actually reading that before this flared up. And so it's a lot of the names in the news are quite familiar.